Direction point! Direction point!
A Doctor Who podcast network.
Well, hi everybody. Welcome back to Doctor Who Literature. My name is Jason. This is a pre-recorded episode as I am out of town this weekend. It is going to be Target Book number 109, the novelization of Fury from the Deep, a classic adventure of the Second Doctor, now a bumper volume. A unique book, and a very rewarding one, featuring one of the longest audio essays that I've done in a long time. I've been doing a lot of 10-minute reviews lately, but this is a book that deserves a full deep dive exploration. Fury from the Deep. Deep dive? Pardon the pun. You're welcome. Cannot be happier to have back Conrad Westmaas. Conrad is joining me for what is more just a candid recording of an audio chat between two friends. We do get to the book eventually, but there's a lot of diversions and sidesteps that I think are the most interesting part of the chat. Hopefully you agree. We do talk about the book, and we have a lot to say about it. But Conrad and I talk for about an hour, and we always have a lot to say to each other. I was going to preface this story with a tale about my interest in baseball and the unique goings-on in Major League Baseball in October 1986. However, because this is a pre-recorded episode, and because we're going to be running long with my longer audio breakdown of the book, and because next week's episode is also an October 1986 book, I am going to defer that story to next week. I am also going to defer any discussion of Doctor Who news this week, since it's relatively early in the week as I speak these words, and if there is going to be any major news, it hasn't happened yet. So without any further ado, let's jump in that helicopter, let's fly out over some control rigs, and let's get right down with Fury from the Deep, and let's get to it.
Hi, I'm Rupert Booth.
I am known as Paul Ferry.
And my name is Barry Williams.
Together, we host Time Ram.
Time Ram's a cruel mistress.
It's a random number generator.
That also.
We roll a number from 1 to 30, and that's our Doctor. Then 1 to 300 for the story, and then we ram them together.
Even if it doesn't make sense.
Cruel, I tell you.
Time Ram, putting the wrong Doctors in the wrong stories, so you don't have to.
You're listening to Doctor Who Literature.
And a warm Doctor Who Literature welcome back to Conrad. Conrad, thank you so much for doing this.
Thank you so much for having me back. I was trying to think how many I've done, and I know I've done Planet of the Daleks, Time Warrior, The Two Doctors, and I think I might be missing one. Megalos. So we've done four. This is my
that
fifth.
That would make this your fifth. Now, the long-running American variety slash satire sketch comedy show Saturday Night Live, which has been on since 1975, has what's called a five timers club. So any guest host who's hosted the show five times gets into the five timers club. So that would make you a proud member of the Doctor Who Lit five timers club.
I'm sure Cy Hart is membership card 0001, but I'm very happy to be joining the five time club. Fantastic. Thank you so much. Yeah, fantastic. Thank you very much for having me back.
Now, The Two Doctors was a bit of an asterisk because you were sharing the dais with two other people. And you also submitted, I believe, an audio recording for my 50th episode.
I did, actually. Yes, I did. Yeah.
So this is your
I'm in six
solo interview. Hopefully not your last.
Well, who knows? Because you've only got a year of this left, right?
This is book number 109. And that's a bit misleading. Because
no, this is 110. This is 110.
Right, but it's episode 109 because Vengeance on Varos came out very, very late and came out 2 years after it was supposed to come out. So it came out as book 106 in between, I think, books 127 and 128 or something like that.
Wowzers. Well, it's been fantastic.
The last book is number 156, so that means
I've got about 46 novelizations to go, but I do have two more companions books.
Yes.
And I have Slipback, and I have the Pescatons, and I have the three quote-unquote missing season 23 novelizations. So you're looking at about 52 books yet to come, plus whatever bonus episodes I have in the middle whenever I need to give myself a week off. So we are recording this towards the end of March 2024. That means this podcast will probably be done by about May 2025, barring anything unexpected.
Wow. What a nice body of work. It's sort of sad that it's the end of any podcast, or if it transforms into something else. But as always with a lot of these podcasts, it's like, what a body of work it's built up. I mean, these will be always, anytime anyone wants to research a book or a novel, they've got all of these. Go back and listen to in publication order. That's just fantastic. And I've got a couple of friends who are on the quest to, or have indeed completed, the mission to a full target library. I think a lot of people in lockdown sort of started going for it, and I'm seeing a lot of collections click into place. People are at various, it's like wacky races, people are at various stages of completion. But yeah, very exciting. And it's, I think this is well, I can't have a Sunday night bath without Dog Tooth Literature, so I don't know what's going to happen. When this whole podcast finishes, I'm going to have to find a whole new routine or just get cleaners in. I don't know.
Well, I have a few different options. I've talked about this with other guests. I could always do Doctor Who Literature, the remix. I could have a whole new set of guests and restart the cycle from the first book and go through the entire run of the series again, but never having the same guest on for the book that they covered originally. Now, bearing in mind that my first four episodes had no guests, so the three Frederick Muller books and Spearhead from Space were guestless, I could always finish up the show by having guests on for each of those four.
I think that's
the podcast by a month.
I think just for completionist sake, it's making me slightly itch, the fact that the first four don't have guests on and the rest of them do. We need matching spines on this, Jason. I know you know what I'm talking about. Let's have some guests for those, because that way. But again, what a lovely archive. And this is for anybody who's doing podcasts. It's like they can feel quite disposable. No one's getting paid, or at least if they are, they've kept it quiet from me. So it's a real labour of love. So I think it's lovely when these things build up to a huge sort of body of work. I think that's really exciting for, when we look at Doctor Who being the most researched TV programs. I mean, podcast analysis about any given story is going to be, I think, a really new good mine of information. Anyway, I'm babbling, but hooray for podcasts is basically what I'm trying to say.
I'm in the host's chair, so usually it is my job to shower effusive praise upon my guest of the week. Getting that praise from you is a little bit embarrassing. Number one, because I'm not worthy.
I get away.
Number two, because that's not the position that I'm usually in.
We're not doing modesty in 2024. Do you know what? Life's hard. Any little wins you get, we just have to shout about.
There are also some books towards the beginning when I didn't know what the shape of this podcast was going to be. I was primarily, for the first 16 books, reading out old blog posts, and I wasn't doing a lot of new research. But then I met a lot of people as the series unfolded. So, for example, Dale Smith was my guest last month for Turlough and the Earthling Dilemma. Yes. Unbeknownst to me, Dale was also researching an essay about that same book for James Couray Smith's Substack, or whatever it's called now that he's on Substack, the Psychic Paper blog. And he put a lot of facts in that essay, which didn't come to light on the show, because he did his own independent research and reached out to primary sources, which I have not been doing. I could also go back and revisit certain books where my first episode sort of shortchanged the original. Joe Short was my guest for Monster of Peloton.
Yes.
It was her first podcast ever. We both had recording problems. I ended up, I think, with a 19-minute interview, so I owe her a full hour somewhere.
You know what? Absolutely. And it's just, you know what? It's actually, although technically that didn't go the way either of you wanted, and of course for your first podcast, having technical issues would have been the nightmare. It would have been going on stage with no trousers, sort of 3 a.m. anxiety. But luckily, Joe Short is amazing. So what you did get there was absolute gold. But also, I think it's really good because it shows that's what podcasting's like. And that's what will happen on your first time. We've all done those ones where you've banged on for about 2 hours about something and someone goes, did anyone hit record? I can't find a file. Yeah, we've all done that pain. So it's part of the rite of the passage. And I just think what's nice about Doctor Who Literature in that particular episode with Joe is that we got to hear that nightmare scenario of, oh no, your first one, technical stuff went wrong. But Joe handled it really well and the stuff you got was great. So when she comes back, all of that will be behind them. You know, I think that's the joy of having different people from different backgrounds and levels of podcast experience and levels of knowledge. It's great. And Smudge, who's now on screen. Something's blocking the impeller pipe. I think it's Smudge.
Smudge has been on video probably for every episode that I've done since I started doing live video chats with people to turn into podcast interviews. She's always there on camera. But I was going to say, I did not know Jim Sangster at all when I started this project.
Wow.
He was deep into his pandemic blog through of the Target books. I didn't know that existed until well into 2022 when I discovered it. And then Graham Burke did the introductions, and now I can't imagine doing this show without Jim.
No.
Not only that, between the logo and the humor and the comedy that he provides and the knowledge that he provides, I can't imagine that I did this show for 50, 60 books without him on board. And it's just unthinkable to me that I was able to get as many episodes in the can without him or his insights or his music or his connections or his knowledge. Wow. So
what a powerhouse.
I always go back and redo up until the point where Jim joined.
There we go. The pre-Jim era. The pre-Jim era. Yeah, absolutely. It's funny. I first met Jim on my very first day that I did an audio, a Peter Davison audio called Omega. And Jim had a part on that. So to be honest, I can't really record unless Smudge is on camera or Jim is in the vicinity. This is just how podcasting and recording works now.
We'll call it the blue spine era, because you know that they did not allow Target to produce any painting of a past doctor while the current doctor was on the air, which means after the TV series goes off the air, they start releasing the blue spines. So you get covers to novelizations with the appropriate doctor on them. Yeah. So I would have a blue spine edition of the show. Any episode that didn't have Jim, I can go back and include Jim.
There we go. There we go. Love that. Good old Jim. No, the work that's done on this podcast has just been wonderful. It's found its groove, but it still keeps evolving. I mean, just by the nature of having very different people on here, it's so exciting. So hats off to everyone who's been on it so far, because it's always been an interesting listen. It's never not interesting.
And speaking of hats off, you had made a reference earlier to being on stage without your trousers. Have you ever done a recording without trousers?
Notice I'm having to think about this first. Have I ever done a recording without trousers? Yes, I have, but not an audio recording. And I think we're just going to draw a line under that. In professional circumstances, I have recorded without trousers. But it was all above board and in the script. It's all fine. But no, normally, we're the nice thing about audio is that it doesn't matter what you look like. So whether you're wearing all or nothing, it's all good.
And of course, when you're playing Karras, he is not even human. So you're putting yourself in full, I guess, lizard makeup.
Oh, yeah. A lot of people said, as a convention star, would you go the full, like, prosthetics and stuff? And I'm like, abso-bloody-lutely. I mean, I basically have realized that I am Alan Rickman from Galaxy Quest, and I'm embracing that to the absolute max. British actor, had a little bit of dabble with Shakespeare. Career's not quite what it was at conventions with a purple head going, by Grubthar's hammer. marvelous. I've got to tell you a story, actually. I saw Alan Rickman. I saw him twice, actually. But the second time I saw him, I was at the dropping names here. I was at the Globe Theatre seeing a production of Romeo and Juliet. This production of Romeo and Juliet was some sort of, it was only running for a short run. It seemed to be in the daytimes for schools. And the lead Romeo, I can't remember who he was called, but he was someone from EastEnders. He was basically some boy from EastEnders. And my friend who I was there with just nudged me during the middle of the performance. And I was like, what? And she just nodded over to a few rows there beside us. And I could see the unmistakable silhouette of Alan Rickman's face. And he just sat there looking like a miserable hawk, a miserable, majestic hawk. But every time the guy playing Romeo from EastEnders opened his mouth, his eyes would close and his face would just be the picture of disdain. He'd sort of give a every time he spoke. It was glorious.
Oh my goodness.
That was a tangent. I'm so sorry. That I just Alan Rickman. But yes, I will be wearing, we're actually doing a convention. I think India, Paul and I are doing a convention in May. I think it's sold out, but it's the first time. I think we're trying to work it out. I think it's the first time we've done a convention, the three of us, since about 2004. So it's that's going to be fun. And there may be some coming up later on this year. If you're listening to this, especially if you're in America and you host a Doctor Who convention and you want two old middle-class lovies turning up and telling dirty stories on your stage, please invite Indy Fisher and Conrad Westmaas along. We'd love to come. As I said, 2024 is the year of no apologies, no modesty, no shame. Life is hard. We have to take the wins where we can. So you have a marvellous podcast. I've been very lucky to have some audio stuff. It's all about making hay while the sun shines. So, yeah, a bit of convention stuff this year, which should be fun.
This will be probably the first year in a long time that I'm missing L.I. Who, because I will be over probably in the UK in August. So this will be that's going to be the week of L.I. Who. It'll be the first time that I'm going to miss that. I'm thinking about possibly going to Chicago TARDIS instead towards the end of the year. But that's American Thanksgiving weekend, which is a bit tough to get away for. I will say that I have been to the Globe Theatre the very first time we were in London. It must have been 2018. My family and I did the Globe Theatre tour. I would love to see a show there, but I've never been able to line it up. But, you know, my daughter would have been, I think, 8 years old the first time that we did the Globe Theatre tour. And you never know what an 8 year old is going to say, but my kid has no, she's been on the show. She has no filter. She will say exactly what she's thinking. And it's usually very wise and well thought out. So, you know, the very erudite tour guide is leading us through the bowl of the theater, walking around the seats, going towards the stage. Tour guide asks the children on tour whether or not they were familiar with Shakespeare. So my daughter raises her hand. And this was unrehearsed. I didn't tell her what to say. I had no idea why she was raising her hand. Tour guide asks, young lady, what do you know about Shakespeare? And she goes, he copied his plays from other people. I'm like,
oh, wow.
You're going to get thrown out by Globe Security. Well,
the tower is only just down the road. You've got to be careful over here. My good, I love that. And to also, not wrong. Zero. Fabulous. Full marks. Always good to, you know, if our dates line up, let's go to the Globe. I can usually beg, borrow, steal or wangle some tickets to most things if I put my mind to it, so we could go there. Because, and this is actually good for anybody really, like if you haven't been or haven't been recently, I haven't been for years, you can usually turn up and get a ticket for a fiver as a groundling standing up, and it's always worth it. Go to the Globe.
I am kind of embarrassed to admit, native New Yorker, born and raised, I've lived in New York probably for about 40 of my 50 years. I've once been to Shakespeare in the Park. Now, Shakespeare in the Park is the New York City summer institution. The Delacorte Theater is a small open-air theater with wooden benches, not proper seats, in the middle of Central Park. And they do usually two Shakespeare plays each summer, and they attract incredible talent, so you never know who is going to be on stage performing at Shakespeare in the Park. The only time that I ever went was in the year 2000, and it was for A Winter's Tale, which, in terms of the most famous of Shakespeare's plays on a scale of Pyramids of Mars through Blink, probably falls somewhere around the Vampires in Venice scale.
Right.
People aren't usually getting out of their house to go, I must go see.
Yeah.
And the lead actor was a 1980s American sitcom star who later got into serious legal trouble while dabbling in the real estate market. So he's not exactly the most, profound Shakespearean scholar performing. But I believe Keith David from one of my favorite movies, The Thing, did perform in the play as well.
So wow. It was very impressive. Wow. Amazing. Gosh. Absolutely. I must get out to more theatre. I'm terrible. I haven't been for years. Oh, that sounds wonderful. And also, you say wooden bench. It hasn't got real seats. It's wooden benches. It's like, well, the real seats for a theatre were, there were none. You were standing. And if there were seats, they would be wooden benches with the ground covered in orange peel and piss. And, that's what theatre was. And at the Globe, it still is, although the hygiene standards have slightly improved. In the audience, at least, the actors are clearly still revolting.
I know in the TSV novelization of City of Death, I believe written by David Lawrence, an actor himself, commissioned by Paul Scoons, friend of this show, the prologue to that novelization of City of Death is the Fourth Doctor taking Romana back in time to the Globe Theater to see Hamlet. And that is one of my, I mean, if I ever get a time machine, that is one of my top 10 historical destinations.
Yeah.
Because the people who would have been seeing it in the early 1600s were not aware that this was Hamlet. And my understanding is that it was a different play every day. So it wasn't like Hamlet was booked for a, you know, 12-week engagement or, you know, running for 30 years like Cats did or Phantom of the Opera did here in the States. It was there a day, and then it may have been put on again. I don't know. But nobody knew that it was Hamlet. And we don't know which version was put on because, you know, you have the bad quarto, you have the folio edition.
Yeah.
I would love to know what that Hamlet sounded like. And, of course, the kicker is it wasn't the Hamlet that we read today, because the Hamlet that we read today, whether it's the Folger's edition or what have you, has been edited for the modern audience. Like, her name wasn't Gertrude in the original play as it was put on. It was Gertrude. Oh, my God, Gertrude. So things like that. So to the extent that I could understand what was going on, I would love to see that and know what the reaction was.
Amazing. It's funny talking about all these quartos and different folios and stuff. I live in Oxford. I'm attached to an academic, not physically. And one of his friends and colleagues, one of our friends and his colleague, my friend, who we've known for years, is an incredibly high up professor of Shakespeare at Hartford College called Emma Smith. She's on Twitter at Old Fortunatus. That's on Twitter at Old Fortunatus. And she was one of the people that discovered the latest folio, you know, so, and has written about it. But I'm bringing her up particularly because if basically just buy her books on Shakespeare, it's like how to watch Shakespeare. And it's real, it's not reverential, it's factual, like rigorously factual, but very intelligent, but very encouraging. That Shakespeare, just get in, it just, if you're interested in Shakespeare, just get her books. They are wonderful. She's not particularly a friend of mine that I'm plugging her books. They're just like, they're great ones to read. It's all gone very theatrical. We've gone very highbrow, haven't we? Normally I get my voice out and lower the tone. We've all gone very theatrical and highbrow. Look at us.
Speaking of highbrow, the name of this podcast was shamelessly stolen from the History of Literature podcast. Emma Smith was on that show within the last year because she was on episode 475, and they're right now in the 520s. They do two episodes a week, whatever number they're up to. She was on the show within the last year, and I did listen to it. But I don't listen to every guest because a lot of the books I haven't read, but she was doing an episode about the folios.
Wow.
So I would port people over to History of Literature, which is a show that I can't help emulating. In fact, when I first planned this show and I designed it, I registered it as the History of Doctor Who Literature until I realized that was possibly copyright infringement and cut it down to Doctor Who Literature.
Just while you're a lawyer.
Which is why, until Jim Sangster came on board, my logo actually said the History of Doctor Who Literature podcast.
Fascinating. But see, we're getting the, now this is the making of.
If I could get Emma Smith on this show, then we'd have the first guest who was ever on both History of Literature program.
They're very in demand, so good luck with that. But wonderful stuff. Wow, so we've gone all Shakespearean. We've gone into theatre, and now it's back to book, really, another form of literature. With
Let's
this wonderful
talk about
book.
Books, then.
Yeah, why not?
Well, you and I had a conversation offline last month,
we
were talking about my Doctor Who Find Your Fate book written by William Emms from 1986.
Yes.
There were six of those published, I think, and I used to have two or three, but those were lost in the great purge of Jason's stuff. But I did get the William Emms book at Galley probably a few years ago, and I would have gotten it for cheap, and I see that on eBay now it's going for $75, so I'll read it and then I'll probably sell it for the cash. But I have, since you and I discussed the Doctor Who Find Your Fate books, which are a knockoff of the Choose Your Own Adventure line, I have been kind of low-key obsessed with rebuilding my Choose Your Own Adventure books. I started reading those before I got into the Target novelization. So I got into Doctor Who at age 11. Most UK fans were into Doctor Who from birth or from very early on. I had other book obsessions long before I got to the Target books in 1985, and Choose Your Own Adventure for a good couple of years was pretty much 90% of what I read.
Yeah.
And I would get some out of the library, but I also owned probably about 20 or 30.
Wow. And
I had some of the knockoff series too. I had Pocket Books was a rival publisher, but they also had the Star Trek license, and they were putting out these Star Trek novels throughout the 1980s. So they did a Star Trek Choose Your Own Way books. That was their line. Total ripoff. Star Trek. Do you go into engineering or sciences? And then whatever, which track you take. And somewhere in the book, I have a plot where you go back in time and the very first captain of the Enterprise in what was the then canon. So I don't know if the Doctor Who Find Your Fates are as good, but there's a lot of material out there. But I've now been low-key obsessed with rebuilding my Choose Your Own Adventure collection, because those a long time ago, long before the Great Purge of Jason stuff. So I've been going on. It was 184 books. The original series ran for 20 years. I'm not going to buy all those. Then it was wound down, and then there were competing rival lines from the people who created the line. I guess they had a falling out. So Edward Packard had his own series, and then R.A. Montgomery reissued some of his books under a slightly new cover format, and there's a whole new line of R.A. Montgomery Choose Your Own Adventures only. I'm not going to buy the whole series because I had stopped reading long before that run ended, but maybe buy the first 40 books, which are the ones that I would have been reading, and just read those over again. In fact, yeah, there would be another podcast idea, which possibly has a slightly more wider target audience than the very small niche Doctor Who literature. Just me and a guest pick a different Choose Your Own Adventure each week and each read it through one path and compare and see where we ended up.
And you have to do every path, so this podcast is basically infinite, I'm sure.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, if a book has 30 endings, you can do 30 episodes on the
book. There you go. You'd never get bored.
I mean, there was a strategy to Choose Your Own Adventure, because if one path took you to page 6 and the other to page 79, it was likely the page 79 path was going to be very, very short. So sometimes I'd read the books just taking the longest possible path and always picking the smaller number.
Yeah.
It didn't always work, but it was a strategy to prolong gameplay and ensure you got a happy ending.
Yeah, it's good times. I remember the Choose Your Own Adventure books over here. They're a series, I think, written by Steve Livingston. I'm sure people, nerds who know about this stuff, will be shouting at me. I think it's Steve Livingston, and it was things like Death Trap Dungeon, and they had incredible artwork in them, and I loved them. But I got told off at school in English Lit. We had to read a certain amount of books, and on my list, and he'd come around and see which book you're reading, and I'd show him Death Trap Dungeon, and I was told, that's not a book, that's a toy. And I just like, okay, thanks for your encouragement in reading. But I learned as well that you had to list all the books you were reading, and I wasn't reading that many books. All the books I were reading were Doctor Who, and having been told off about Choose Your Adventure, being told off by Doctor Who, I now just write the books I was reading were Enlightenment, Fury from the Deep, The King's Demon, State of Decay. Then he must have thought, oh, he's reading some very interesting, challenging material, as indeed I was. Don't shame kids for reading. If they're reading anything, a comic, back of a cereal packet, let them read it. They're enjoying reading. Leave them alone. So, yeah, I love the Choose Your Own Adventure books. And I must shout out to the wonderful Eric Grissom, who is from the old Doctor Who show, has published a wonderful Choose Your Adventure book for a sort of younger 9 to 13 audience called On the Island of the Mad Magician. On the Island of the Mad Magician by Eric Grissom. I bought it for my niece, and I bought it for a friend's daughter for Christmas, and they loved it. So Choose Your Own Adventures are live and kicking.
And there were also the two Doctor Who role-playing game books. Those were American. And there was one with the fourth Doctor called The Vortex Crystal, and then a second one with the sixth Doctor called The Rebel's Gamble, where they're relitigating the Civil War.
You've got to do these. I know this is Target, but you should have a big old space for sundries. And also, what about those... I don't know if they were published under Target. There were two books. Cy Hart's mentioned these before. There was Terry Nation's Daleks book, a paperback, which had stories, all sorts of stuff, and Canine and Other Mechanical Creatures. They might be worth looking. Would you look at those? They're not novels.
People have asked me. I say people, thousands of folks are writing to me. Two or three people have asked me if I'm doing the nonfiction. I'm not planning on doing that, but I will say that I had The Adventures of K-9 and Other Mechanical Creatures, and the binding fell apart. So I had it.
Yeah, they do fall apart. Yeah.
Held together with scotch tape. And that was basically, I think it was the Doctor writing as the fourth Doctor. And it's kind of fictional. The Terry Nation Daleks book I've never seen, let alone read, but I think I'm just sticking with the official numbered targets and then the associated, you know, the companions books and the season 23s. I could go on forever with this podcast if I were to do every single jot and tittle, but I have other things that I want to do. Say. Sorry?
I'm glad you said that, not me. I wouldn't like to say that.
I've been banned from saying that around that. When you have a teen girl, there's a lot of words that I'm banned from saying. That is one of them.
I've never heard that. I didn't even catch it. I'm not sure I even heard it. What about, so you've got the companion thing. Now, what about Slipback and linking into the book we're going to be talking about, the Pescatons? Will you be doing those?
Yeah, those are both official Target releases. I think the Pescatons was numbered and Slipback was not. But Slipback is coming up within the next couple of months, and I have a guest lined up. And the Pescatons will be one of the very last things that I ever do, even if it kills me.
Excellent. Good stuff. Slipback and the Pescatons written. Now, is that the only other thing written by Victor Pemberton, apart from Fury from the Deep?
To my knowledge.
I mean, Doctor Who-wise, obviously. Yeah. Wow.
And, of course, Fury from the Deep was not even an original story. It was basically an adaptation of his own radio series, The Slide, which is available as an audio play on the animated DVD. But just for members who are tuning in the middle of the show, welcome to Doctor Who Literature. This is a show where we occasionally talk about Doctor Who books. So far, 30 minutes in, Conrad and I are just rapping along. I don't know if you mentioned Doctor Who once. So let's segue neatly into Doctor Who, and we're going to talk, of course, about Big Finish Audio. Tell me what is up in the world of Keras.
Oh my goodness. Okay, yeah, for people who don't know what this is, so 20 years ago...
People don't know what this is. This is the Doctor Who... Doctor Who podcast. There is nobody who doesn't know who that is.
This is a literature book. Keras hasn't been in a book. Actually, that's a lie. He was in a Short Trips once. Anyway, so 20 years ago, I joined Paul McGann and Indy Fisher as playing the part of Keras in the Big Finish 8th Doctor audios. It was a very experimental time in Doctor Who. Some of it was good. Some of it was appalling. But we crashed through it. We came back to the real universe. I fought Daleks, Davros, Omega, Rassilon, you know, and had lots of adventures. Didn't do any. For about 17 years. Got a phone call last year. Conrad, would you come into the studio and record a new one with India and Paul? And I said, yes. And it was my good friend Lizzie Hopley, who's a writer. And it was part of the Sontarans versus Rutans story. Now, having been on the Doctor Who Literature podcast, I've done the Time Warrior, did a reading for that, did the Two Doctors with Fraser and the Co. So you know my feelings on a Sontaran. I love the Sontarans. I also love The Horror of Fang Rock, which just came out of the BFI and is now on season 15. Sontarans and Rutans are the on-trend monsters of 2024. So I was in one of the stories, the Battle of Giants Causeway, that we recorded last May, that came out in January and has been very well received. They're now on to, I think, the third in the little box set of Sontarans versus Rutans with different doctors and companions. But that's been enormous fun. So, yeah, that's what's been going on in the world of Big Finish for me.
And I forgot to mention, I was remiss. There was another episode of Doctor Who Literature that you did last summer when I had COVID and I lost my voice. I needed somebody to read my lines, and I hired my favorite actor, you. And you,
thank you.
You read my script for me that week. It was a bonus episode, so there was not a whole audio essay. But you made sure to work into the script that you are canon.
Hey, I'm thinking of putting it on a t-shirt. In fact, it was Pete Lambert, friend of the podcast, who once said I should wear a t-shirt at conventions, or if there's any doubt, that just says, I'm gonna have to not say the third word, but it's I'm canon B word, in the way that Brittany and would say that sort of thing. I'm canon. I don't know, I've gone very coy. I think this is a well-behaved podcast. I've done some Big Finish and that's been a huge fun. We're doing some conventions this year. I might have done a couple of other little things, but we shall see. I'm generally interested in enjoying this year. And I haven't done loads of podcasts, and now suddenly I've got like tons of them all at once. So is now a good time to tell people what that is?
I've heard you this year on Sirens of Audio, which was incredible. That was your entire biography, by the way. That was
no, I didn't know what that was. I was like, oh yeah, we want to talk about Big Finish. They were like, so where were you born? I was like, we're doing this, are we? Yeah, that was wonderful. I enjoyed that.
You were going deep into it in a way that I've never had to do on this show. And then I heard you on Too Hot for TV, which is a show that I'd not heard of, but the first episode that I listened to was your episode. And then Michael Storm, who was on this show a couple of weeks ago, was also going to be on that show.
Love that one.
So we are becoming a feeder podcast, or a minor league farm system for Too Hot for TV.
Yeah, I know. It's amazing. They're all connected. So the ones I'm doing got coming up are Pieces of Eight, which is a McGann Audio podcast with the wonderful Kenny Smith. Do you know? You're familiar?
I met him in Galley last year. I tried desperately to have him on the show. We were not able to get a recording together, but he's still on my back burner.
Great. Everyone should have Kenny Smith.
I listened to that show, especially when I cover the Eighth Doctor books, which I'm very familiar with. So, yes. Great show. Superb. Great show. Great guy.
Love that. Pieces of Eight, listen out for that too. So that's going to be me, along with Lizzie Hopley, the writer of The Battle of Giant's Causeway, Sontarans versus Rutan. So I guess we'll be talking about McGann Audios. Then I'm on a new one, well, a new one for me, called Tales of the Hooniverse. I think it's having a little reboot. You'll find it on Twitter at T-O-T Hooniverse, T-O-T Hooniverse, Tales of the Hooniverse. That's streaming in April. I don't know what it's about. I think it's about Big Finish and the latest audio. So again, Big Finish or Eighth Doctor fans, listen to that. It's on some streaming platform or a podcast. I've asked about four times, but I'm quite old and I can't quite understand what they're saying. I will just turn up and be on some screen or talking. Then I'm also on Two Hopper TV again with Dylan Reese and Pete Lambert. It's a trio of a podcast, Two Hopper TV, and it's the oddest mix of stuff we've ever reviewed. I didn't expect there to be three of us. Choices were made, but if you like the Rani, you may want to listen to that one. And then Jason, excitingly for us, and I've had to write all this down, and I really realised how behind I am on stuff, we are also going to be doing the Trap 1 review of the Celestial Toymaker animation. So I believe you've got the book coming up soon, right?
The book is coming up in less than a month. It is a little bit in flux as to who my guest is going to be, but I am going to have a very solid episode for that one, and I'm very excited to bring it because, as you're aware, the Celestial Toymaker book is a little controversial. We're not quite sure who wrote it. One of the two names on the covers might not have been involved past page five, but there is now a novelization out of the second Celestial Toymaker TV series, The Giggle, which obviously is one of the most recent Doctor Who episodes as we record this. Mm-hmm. A novelization of The Giggle is out in the UK. It has not yet hit US distribution, but I got my copy through a third-party vendor. It arrives very soon. And I am hoping to tie my discussion of the Celestial Toymaker book into the novelization of The Giggle, which I understand is much, much better in terms of literary content and style and humor and just general prose. So I'm very excited to tie that in. And I'm vague booking a little bit, but stay tuned for that episode and you may be getting two books for the price of one.
Did you just say vague booking?
Yes.
What's that? Is that a young person's thing?
Vague booking. It is a young person's thing, so I shouldn't be using it. My daughter.
No, tell me. No, I'm trying to learn
one
words.
One of the words that I'm not allowed to use, young person slang.
So does your daughter use this? Notice the sound of hope in my voice. I was like, oh, is this a cool word? If I drop it into a sentence, people will think I'm current.
This goes to vague. Facebook. People, and now this is spread to all of the social media, people will post things on Facebook without saying what they mean. Wish me luck, or that was a really bad day, or I'm never speaking to somebody again, and they know who they are.
Right.
So it's called vague booking instead of Facebooking.
Okay, thanks. I'll probably never use that.
Don't. Okay. It marks you out as very uncool. If I'm using it, it's a slang you should never be using.
Okay, great. That's good to know. But yeah, looking forward to this Celestial Toymaker animation, which I saw at the BFI. And oh my goodness, that's a hot topic and a talking point. That's going to be very, very, very interesting.
So speaking of animation, let's segue neatly into our discussion of what's the topic this week?
We're doing Fury from the Deep, people.
Oh, really? Oh, come on. I hate that book. Oh, wait, no, sorry. Anyway, that's a hot mic, isn't it? We'll start off with the Darren Mooney question. Number one. Does Fury from the Deep, the TV serial, belong on a list of the 60 best Doctor Who stories of the last 60 years?
Yeah. Yeah, it does.
See, I started those questions about 3 months ago, and we've been in a run of novelizations of unpopular TV stories. This is one of the first times that I've actually gotten an unreserved yes answer to that question. And yes, Fury from the Deep is number 49 on my list of 60. It didn't make it high up, but it made the top 60 at all. So that's quite an achievement.
That's an incredible achievement, especially for a story that's just there's hardly any of it for us to get to grips with. But yeah, it does, because it's such an unusual story and it's well made and it's yes, it's you know, it can be accused as being a sort of base under siege, blah blah, but actually it's doing a lot more than that, and it's different and it's unusual and it stands on its own, and yet it does tie into, it pulls on so many strings of Doctor Who, you know, the fear of industrialization we get through Pertwee with giant maggots and stuff. It also Doctor Who monsters rising out of the sea, you know, with that's Full Circle or Curse of Fenric or Sea Devils, love monsters in the sea. It's a very interesting story. So yes, it does, and that was proven right because it's in Jason's as well. Hooray!
And the reason why it made my list, even though we can't see it with an asterisk, is because it's one of the few Doctor Who's, especially of its time, that is written as a proper, full-on, four-dimensional drama. So it's not just a story of monsters putting a base under siege. It is a story about what emotions the characters are going through. There is a long-running debate between Robson and Harris as to what's better, field experience or book learning. And this story comes down on the side of book learning, which is good because most American dramas would always go in the other direction and go on the side of street smarts versus – I live in a very anti-intellectual country, in case you hadn't noticed. So that night, you have Victoria getting a full-on story arc. Not only does she leave in the last 5 minutes of the final episode, but that is threaded through the entire story in a way that had not been done since Dalek Invasion of Earth.
Brilliant. Yeah, really beautiful stuff. You're right, the characterization stuff. And, you know, the book as well. It's worth saying, of course, this is a huge book, a page count of 189. Is this the longest Target book, the biggest page count?
It is the longest to date, going back to episode one of this podcast. There may be a McCoy book or two coming up at the very end of the run, which challenges, but I believe this is the all-time record holder, I believe.
Amazing.
Not counting Turlough and the Earthlink Dilemma, which is a little bit longer.
That's not true. A novelization. It isn't. And it's 189 pages, and that type is not that big. I had to squint. I mean, I have squint at all times now, but, you know, it's also long page count and small, you know, small font. So it's a... And I remember the time, because I noticed this came out in 86. I read this in 87. I know this because I was on holiday in Greece, and this was a book that I chose to take with me, age 16. It seemed appropriate seaside reading. So I remember it from then. And it seemed a bit more adult, which is quite nice. I kind of liked the way, because I was being 16 years old, I wanted Doctor Who to be a bit more serious. And so the fact that the books had, you know, Ian Martyr and the invasion, where someone says bastard, you know, that's so exciting. And now this is a classic adventure. It's a bumper volume. It costs £1.95 instead of £1. Would it have been 25 by then, or would it have gone up to 50? I wonder. I think it was 120. I think Cy the other week was railing against it being 125, but this one went up to 195.
This was the first American book that was $3.50, because they were $2.95 for the longest time. Then they were $3.25. This one kicks it up to $3.50.
My goodness. So it felt a bit, had a bit more cachet to it. And also it's funny, just looking at this book now, like just ones with the neon logo and ones with that cool Target. I prefer the Target logo that's got the colours in it, because it feels like Tom Baker's scarf. But actually this sort of monochrome neon-y one they've done, line drawing version of the logo, this is quite an appealing book. Number 110. There's a lot of these books. It's a catalogue we can collect. The missingness of it. I think this book is just really, it's one that just, as a teenager, I felt proud to have this in my pocket. You know, I could take this on holiday and feel all right about myself.
Second Darren Mooney question, is Fury from the Deep on your personal list of your 60 favorite Doctor Who stories?
Yeah, I've never made a list of one. I'm not a list person, but I absolutely would. I know it would be. There are certain stories that I know would be, you know, Greatest Show, Full Circle, Horror Fang Rock. Fury from the Deep, definitely.
I covered this during my Two Doctors episode, and you gave the same answer, so I should have known.
Did I?
That again.
Oh, God, no, I'm so sorry. I've just got no imagination, so I will say the same thing.
You are consistent. I am forgetful. I'd rather be you.
Wow, I would not wish that on anybody. But yeah, I feel glad. I feel actually enough to be fond of this in a different way. I we all go through our phases of, oh, I'm a teenager, I don't like Doctor Who. And there's a bit of that going on during... Ark of Infinity, Mordred Undead. I was like, I don't think this is for me. But I stuck on. And also, I think a lot of this has got to do with J&T. You know, a lot of the decisions he made about the merchandise and the books, it's like they now look good. The covers of this era, those beautiful airbrush Skilliter. This is David McAllister. But like the beautiful paintings, they just feel classier.
This is an eye-popping cover, and the spine is not quite sea green, but the color of the spine ties into the theme of the book because it is sort of a watery color.
Love that. And I noticed as well at the back pages, fantastic Doctor Who poster offers where readers can send off £2.50 and £1.25 for additional posters. And in 28 days, you can make a check or postal order and you would get one of five posters, one of which I had, which has got Davison and a Dalek with lots of as a montage of covers. The one is the death to the Daleks, Roy Knight cover. One my friend Jim had, which was Pertwee wrestling a Sontaran from the Time Warriors. Always comes back to Sontarans. One is a cutaway, you know, one of those Dalek cross sections that we know and love. I'm not sure where it's from. And then one Pete would like, it's the cover of this Doctor and the Cybermen book with those lovely moon based Cybermen in space pointing.
And it's amazing. Funny that you should mention that, because I believe that Pete Lambert was the very first time on this show. His first appearance was episode 12, Doctor Who and the Cybermen, the novelization.
It was. Yeah, absolutely. So I think I can feel J&T's influence in my fandom here. Like I would have been getting Doctor Who magazine. I would have been getting the Targets, felt nice. There was posters to send off for fine art castings, bits and bobs. Like this is where his real understanding of Doctor Who as an entity kind of kicks in. Sorry, hang on. I'll say that again. This is really where his understanding or our understanding of Doctor Who as a sort of entity or what we call franchise really kicks in.
And this is where I'm going to cheat a little bit. I'm going to shake up the third question. Normally, Darren Mooney asks, if a listener has not watched this movie, do you recommend they pause the podcast, stream the movie to a local device, watch the movie, and then come back and listen to the rest of the episode? There are two current ways of watching Fury from the Deep with your eyesight, or in my case, my rapidly failing eyesight. There is the Loose Cannon reconstruction, which you can get on the Loose Cannon Daily Motion channel. And that is one way to watch this story. The first time that I watched Fury from the Deep properly was as a fan-made recon in the 1990s before Loose Cannon. And I was watching this on VHS on a 19-inch TV during my law school years. And it's an incredible story, even as a blurry telesnap recon. As long as you have a recon that gives you the text, you can hear what's going on the soundtrack. It's got some really good cliffhangers. I'll come back and discuss that in the audio essay half of this show. And again, the emotional content of the script makes it a cut above even the rest of season 5, which has a very strong reputation in fandom. So the other way of watching the story is the recent full-color HD animation. Before I reveal my thoughts on that topic, I want to ask you, as my guest in the hot seat, which of those two versions would you recommend a listener who has not seen Fury from the Deep pause the podcast, either stream to a local device or watch on animated Blu-ray? Which version of the TV story do you recommend?
I'm going to hedge my bets, and I'm actually going to say I recommend any of them, to be honest. Now, my personal favorite would be to do a Telesnap reconstruction. I know everyone, I hear so many people on podcasts going, well, of course, I can't watch Telesnaps. I'm like, I don't know why not. What's wrong with you? All of the audio is on there. They will give the closest amount of pictures that there are, and you can fill it in. I don't see what the problem is here. So I very much enjoy those. The animation, like the animations, as we all know, they're on a budget, that nothing is perfect, but it's very, very watchable. And there are they've made some good creative choices with the seaweed zombies, the helicopter chase with giant seaweed coming out of the sea. I would watch, if I was going to watch an animation, I'd watch it in black and white, preferably, because I prefer black and white to color. But go nuts. Go full color with a new Celestial Toymaker one, by all means. You know, just do whatever, you know, whatever's good. I would do a Daily Motion one. Do you know what? Even just today, I thought, I'm just going to watch all the surviving clips and give myself a 6-minute version of Fury from the Deep. Do that. Do any blinking version of Fury from the Deep. Just read the book. The book is really weird and very like the series. I think it's quite a robust story. It can take lots of different formats. So that, sorry to hedge my bets, but any format's a good one. I'm going Telesnaps probably.
There's a couple of opinions that set my teeth on edge, and I believe these opinions disqualify somebody from hosting a podcast. Those opinions are, number one, I don't like this 1960s or 70s Doctor Who serial because it's two episodes too long. First of all, these are not movies. They weren't written as self-contained movies. They were written as serials, so each episode has to recap the week before for the benefit of the person who wasn't there. So if you watch The Invasion as a single movie, it is not a movie. It literally wasn't meant to be one. You can't watch it that way. Also, when you say this serial is two episodes too long, what you're saying is, I don't like Doctor Who, and I wish there was less of it in the archives. I just cannot get on board with that opinion.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I've had to kind of just calm down and not join in with a lot of conversations, because I think just I've realized that my tastes are just very different. You know, the Doctor Who color, the colorized Doctor Who they did is sort of cut down and colorized. I sort of understand the reason, the rationale behind doing that, but I would rather gouge my eyes out with a rusty spoon than watch Doctor Who colorized. I heard a very good description once that coloring black and white film is like serving up a really good steak with a custard poured over the top, and that's what I feel like. So while a lot of these endeavors are like, oh, it's wonderful, yeah, great, cut down, colorized, marvelous, pour marmalade on it, do what you like, to me it's an abomination. But then again, I'm not a purist, because the new, as I said, the animations, I'm like, go nuts, don't just recreate it, do something else. And so I you know, there is some sort of wiggle room, but I think this is a good, robust, I think it's actually a classic. It's a classic type of story. I think it's classic in the same way that Tomb of the Cybermen's classic, because it's just got mystique and cachet about it. But I think, you know, and in the Doctor Who magazine 25th anniversary poll in 1988, this was voted the best Target novel ever. And I think that speaks to, like, that's why us teenagers were like, this is the ultimate. It's missing, it's rare. And it's a long book. It's kind of a bit adult. Like, it's this story's never not been exciting to me or mysterious.
The other opinion that upsets me is when somebody says, I don't watch Telesnap recons. I can forgive that if you've only just discovered the show in the last 5 years and you're trying to watch the entire back catalog. And maybe you're a little bit younger than us and you come from the streaming age and you don't have a frame of reference. If you are a fan of our era and you became a fan of the show before 2017, before the animations came out, Telesnap recons were the only way to watch 110 episodes before a lot of the missing episodes got rediscovered over the last 15 years. Telesnap recons, number one, it's the closest way to watching the show as it was, low quality pictures, the original soundtrack in black and white. Secondly, recons are the genius of fandom. The BBC says we have destroyed 110 episodes of Doctor Who irrevocably, and that number is now thankfully down to 97. We have destroyed these episodes so you can see them. Doctor Who fan goes, wait a minute, I have the off-air soundtrack, and I have the Cure Telesnaps, or if there are no Telesnaps for that story, I'll just go and invent my own, and I'm going to recreate the story myself, like Mickey Rooney and Judy Garland. I want to put on a show right here in this barn right now. Telesnaps are Doctor Who fandom's gift to Doctor Who. So those recons, all right, they can be difficult to watch. I found myself getting bored and antsy watching the Abominable Snowman during my Twitter pilgrimage in early 2021, before that animation came out. That set my opinion of the story from very high to bottom 10.
Wow.
I don't think that was because of the recon blurriness necessarily. I think it was because the story is just regressive and unfortunate and awful in many respects. But having the recon didn't help. I do have the animation, which I have not watched yet. I will get to that at some point, and maybe I'll have a more charitable opinion of the story then. But for the most part, I love watching the Telesnap recons. And for me, the joy of seeing the Savages for the first time as a recon, as I mentioned last week, or the joy of watching Fury from the Deep on VHS in the 1990s, wow, this is a really underrated story. This is really good. So you can discover a lot about the show from watching the 60s Telesnap recon. So I would promote that. I've been doing a lot of talking, even though this is your hour. I just want to say briefly with the animations, the animators are not doing the original camera script. So you're not seeing Fury from the Deep as it was. You're seeing a modern day interpretation geared to the modern eye. And that's fine. I'm not going to go all Ian Levine on it. But when watching the story becomes a Easter egg content delivery system. Oh, there's the Roger Delgado master. Oh, there's a picture of the Sacha Dhawan master. Oh, there's a callback to a story that wasn't made when this came out in 1967. That's a little less appealing to me because then instead of watching a Doctor Who episode, you're watching an episode about Doctor Who and it becomes a little too meta. So instead of enjoying the story for itself, you're enjoying it for Easter eggs and callbacks.
Yeah.
And to me, that is a lesser means. I love it. I love Easter eggs. Look at me. I love spotting them. But it's a lesser means of storytelling because instead of enjoying the story for what it is, the story about monsters and seaweed and how Victoria screaming saves the day, it's a story about how many references and spoilers can we put in here? And did you notice at the back of the scene there was a picture of the master? No, I'm trying to watch the scene.
I know what you mean. I do know what you mean. Speaking of spoilers, there's one in this book. There's a whopping one in this book. One of the chapter titles is Scream, Victoria, Scream. I'm like, really, people? You couldn't have called it The Deadly Scream. You couldn't have called it... I mean, like, come on, people. But this is, you know, because this is somewhere in between those two things, really, because it's not wildly interpretive, this book. It sticks pretty much to the story with a few embellishments. So it's kind of quite faithful, but because it's a bit longer, and apparently Victor Pemberton put this book proposal in, and they were like, make all these changes. Actually, this was the original script, and he just went, you're not making any changes to the script, so it's as is. And I think when he delivered this book, the novel, what do you call it, a novel? When he delivered the book, the novel, they were like, oh, this is too long, and someone just went, no, well, some... it's too long, it's over the budget, it's over the everything. Somehow that no became a yes. And I thought, well, if he put his foot down with the original script, he probably put his foot down with this. So you're getting something. I was trying to think, like, my notes were like, it's very efficient. It's very economic with the language. It's very, you know, good characterization. And I was like, well, is this just like a Terence Dix then? And it isn't. It's got a bit more meat on the bone just because it's longer. And obviously this guy isn't Terence Dix. And it's his own script he's adapting. So, of course, that's always going to do something different. Overall, as it's only one of two of Victor Pemberton's books, how did you feel his writing? How would you describe his authorial style? Because I'm not sure I can.
I'm going to save some of that for the audio essay, which is coming up in about 8 minutes for you listening at home. I will give a couple of sneak previews. Number one, this is like Terence Dix in the most positive sense. This is top-tier writing. Many of the recent books are by first-time writers or old fossils coming out of the storage locker to write Doctor Who for the first time in 20 years, and they don't quite know how prose works. A lot of the books that we've covered in the last few months and a lot of the books yet to come, The Massacre, are almost unreadable in terms of run-on sentences, and you cannot read them aloud. Terence Dix never has that problem. He does a mixture of short, long, and medium sentences. His paragraphs are propulsive, and nobody adapts a cliffhanger into prose like Terence Dix. Victor Pemberton is doing exactly that, and I'll do a brief impromptu audio reading for myself in the audio essay of his adaptation of one of the cliffhangers. This is some of the best Terence Dix-esque prose we get in the target line, which other authors don't know how to do. The second point is he's not adapting the whole of Fury from the Deep. Fury from the Deep has a lot of dialogue. If you compare the pages of the book and the chapters of the book to the online episode transcript, Pemberton leaves a lot of words out. If he had done a literal transcript of everything said on TV, this book could have been 20 or 30 pages longer. So in fact, this is an abridged version of Fury from the Deep for as long as the book is. Yeah. So I am going to have a very effusively praised audio essay coming up now in about 6 or 7 minutes time.
I love that. Yeah. And I found just overall just recommending this book as one of the versions to recommend. I would recommend this book. It's funny. This was the only, in fact, I think it's the only time I've come on a podcast to review a book or something of a story. And I haven't rewatched the story because I knew this book would be fine to read on its own. I did actually watch just the existing footage, just the existing like 6 minutes of it. But basically, I knew that reading this book would give me everything I knew about the story. And it really did. And it's got great atmosphere, good, sort of very brooding, very melancholic at some point. The characterization is fantastic of Harris and Maggie Harris, very sinister with her possession, Robson's breakdown and the reasons behind it. There is a little unfortunate, sexism back at the time. So Megan Jones particularly is very tiresomely addressed in terms of her attractiveness, because obviously as a woman in authority, it's a three-act play for her. She's first described as attractive in a hard sort of way. The second time was being put on defensive mode made her seem more attractive. And then finally, she's all disheveled after the fighting monsters, it's far more vulnerable and attractive than she had ever revealed before. So, you know, that's awful. But I think, you know, and that's a terrible way to, you know, they should have put that up at the time. But I also think, conversely, using Victoria's scream, you know, the Doctor Who companion scream, and she was particularly screamy, using that as a weapon against the weed creature doesn't feel like pastiche or cruel. That feels like, yeah, good on Victoria, it's your last story, you blink it, no one can scream like Victoria. It's a bit of a plus, it's a bit of a superpower for her, and she gets a lot more to do besides the beautiful ending scene that's seeded all the way through it. Very emotional scenes with Jamie talking about their brother and sister relationship, and the characters along the way, like Oak and Quill, that weird pair, as Jamie calls them, that weird, he says they're like a silent movie comedy double act, and the horror and the creeping horror and the silence and sneakiness of them, I think Victor Pemberton really brings up beautifully. And then there's a big crescendo of action. So to be honest, this book does everything I want it to do. So my overall take is this is great. It's atmospheric, it's action packed. Read it.
See, I don't even need to do the audio essay now because you've said everything much more succinctly than I ever will.
Up against the clock, mate. Yeah.
if your day is busy and you have other things to do, you can hit next podcast in your queue right now.
Never.
Thank you for listening. We'll see you next time. But for everybody else who's sticking around, I will try to recapture in my audio essay the great summary of the book that Conrad has just given us. Victor Pemberton was writing Doctor Who with a literary or theatrical stage play eye, which a lot of other writers at the time were not doing. So he's giving us characters in our lives. But we see this also from the work that he did for the two stories where he was assistant or replacement script editor, because he did this with Tomb of the Cybermen, giving us that famous scene famous for Doctor Who fans, between the Doctor and Victoria towards the end of Part 3, talking about their respective lost families. And he also added a scene into Abominable Snowmen, which again is a story that I have lost faith in, but he has a very good scene in Part 4 where Victoria and Tommy are talking in a prison cell and discussing the nature of the Doctor. And that was all Victor Pemberton. He was giving Doctor Who things that you weren't seeing at this era in the show, because it was plot, 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 plot. He's going, wait a minute, there are very good actors. Let's give them stuff that they can really enjoy.
Yeah, great stuff.
So we are down to our last 84 seconds of recording time on Zoom. So we've already been at this for an hour. We've talked about Fury from the Deep a little bit, but I think we've done it justice because it is a very good story. It's in our respective top 60s. The book, I don't know if it's the best target, like the way that it was found in 1988, but it is definitely, it is one of the top 20 targets probably. What else do you want to say, Conrad, in closing?
Not much really, apart from thank you very much for having me on. I just thoroughly enjoyed reading this. I'm sorry Jason, I'll have to think of something else. Thank you very much for having me on. Nothing much more to say. Read Fury from the Deep, watch Telesnaps, watch animations, go nuts, take this in any format you like, it's all good.
And you are going to be on several other podcasts coming up. You are moving on to bigger and better things, so I might not be able to book you as busy as you're getting. But if I can, you will be on the show again before it winds up, I promise.
Thank you. I will always have time for Doctor Who literature. Thank you so much. Keep turning the pages. Can I say that? I just did.
Doctor Who, Fury from the Deep, by Victor Pemberton. Televised as Fury from the Deep, teleplay by Victor Pemberton. Televised in March and April 1968. Paperback release date, October 16th, 1986. Target book number, 110. Cover artist, David McAllister.
In the dark, uncharted depths of the North Sea, it has lurked, growing in strength, growing in size, and striking terror into the hearts of mariners down the untold centuries. Landing near a North Sea gas refinery off the east coast of England, the TARDIS crew are immediately accused of sabotage. Several rig crews have mysteriously vanished. Strange pressure buildups have been detected. And in the refinery's pipelines, the doctor can hear the steady, rhythmic beat of what? Soon, the doctor, Jamie, and Victoria will find themselves at the unrelenting mercy of the deadliest and most terrifying foe they have ever encountered. A classic adventure of the Second Doctor, now a bumper volume. By October 1986, my target buying circumstances weren't quite the same as they had been in January 1985, the month I became a collector. My parents had separated in the summer of 86, and my father spent the next year living 10 minutes away, a distance that would grow progressively larger over the years, until he now lives in one of those southern red states with book banning and quote-unquote anti-woke laws where I don't visit very often. So I was no longer getting paid one Target book a week for babysitting wages, though I was now on a cash allowance and buying my own books. We still went to the local shopping mall a couple of times a month, and I was still getting Targets, but by October 86, I also had more Target books than I could reasonably read all at once. I do remember the day that I bought Fury from the Deep because I immediately read the first chapter and thought it was one of the best chapters I'd ever read, all 9 pages of it, introducing the sonic screwdriver and seemingly ending with the death of all 3 companions. And one of the great atmospheric Target sentences, page 15, quote, "It took only a few minutes for snowflakes to cover the 3 lifeless bodies spread-eagled forlornly in the sand." I liked that chapter so much that I read it again. I probably read that chapter again 10 times over the next year, liked it so much that I never progressed to chapter 2. It was at least 3 years before I actually read the whole book. This is an odd problem that I find myself confronting down through the ages. I'll buy or be gifted a new book, and I'll be so intent on savoring it that I never get to the end. Still a problem today, I can assure you. And I have much less free time now than I did in 1986, and read much fewer books a year than I used to. At around the same time, late 1986, my grandmother, eager to buy me books that I'd actually read, bought me a short story collection called Bug-Eyed Monsters, a compilation of old sci-fi pulp stories, one of which was written by my grandmother's former next-door neighbor, Isaac Asimov. This is the same grandmother who was in a Hadassah group with Robert Silverberg's mother, so even though she couldn't pronounce Return of the Jedi, she called it Jedi, she did know more than the average person born in 1913 about American sci-fi. I loved this book too. Read that first short story, Stranger Station by Damon Knight, over and over. I don't think I ever read any other short story in that book, ever. But eventually I did read the rest of Fury from the Deep, even if not the rest of Bug-Eyed Monsters, a book that I've since lost. And as Conrad and I discussed, I grew to love the TV serial so much that it ranks as number 49 on my Who 60 for 60 list, the 49th best Doctor Who story ever made. 4 new RTD stories have aired since I wrote that list, and none of them have cracked that list either. In terms of the prose, Victor Pemberton does tend to overwrite things. Jamie is, quote, "very disgruntled." All right, he's disgruntled. We don't need the very. The Doctor's woolen bobble hat is described more than once. The book is 183 pages, and as Graham Burke said on the show a while back, that's because the author got carried away while writing, and the editors didn't have time to slim it down. Plus, I'd add, they could call it a bumper volume and charge more money to the completionist reader who was going to buy it, even if it was only 110 pages long. But those are minor points. Apart from the occasional repetitive phrase, Pemberton lays on the atmosphere very well. Let's read out that first paragraph on page 7. "The sky had never looked more menacing. Huge clusters of dark gray clouds had overwhelmed the early morning sunshine, threatening the approach of a gathering winter storm. And beneath it all, the sea, the cruel, unyielding sea, crammed with dark secrets that man on planet Earth has never fully understood. Quiet and calm now, with small white tufts of foam curling gently across the surface, waiting for the gale force winds to lash them into a frenzy. An ancient mariner once said that if you stand alone on the seashore, You will hear the sound of those who dwell in the deep depths of the ocean. Today was to be just such a day. We're at a curious moment in the target line. Terence Dix has only two paperbacks out in 1986, and will only have two out in 1987. Ian Martyr, we'll talk more about him next week, dies less than 2 weeks after Fury comes out as a paperback. Malcolm Hulk had already died 7 years ago at this point. That means most of the target books are by newbies to the line, and we've already had many one-and-done authors in 1986. Pemberton, William Ems, Glenn McCoy, Tony Atwood, or other writers who are going to be more controversial. Pippin Jane, Eric Saward, Terence Dudley. We're long gone from the days when you'd get 11 books a year, 8 or 9 by Terence, and the rest by some combination of Martyr and Hulk and Jerry Davis. The target offerings are much more varied now, and most of the whales, the great stories, have already been published. So now in 86 we get novelizations of season 22 clunkers, or old black and white stories that no longer exist on video, like Galaxy 4, or this one. We are no longer on familiar turf. But Pemberton writes with an immediacy, and this book is, even for its excesses and other faults that we'll come to, probably the best target book of 1986. Page 19, quote, "The hall was completely circular, like the inside of a mosque." That's interesting prose. Pemberton does a little bit of tell, don't show, as much as he describes the sights and sounds of the main control area. He also, in Chapter 2, tends to tell us a bit too much about each new character before we get to know them through their dialogue or through the TARDIS crew's direct observations and impressions. Maggie Harris, quote, "looked as though she were in her late 20s, but could have been a little older." Huh? We learn in what should have been Victoria's POV section that, quote, "in fact, Robson had always resented the fact that a young man had been appointed to the job, and straight out of university at that." Not something Victoria should know to tell us. Pemberton is at his best describing alien tableau, such as the living, breathing seaweed that attacks Maggie and pops and hisses. What's good about the book's length is that it actually condenses a lot of material. Lots of descriptive prose, but by no means all of the TV's dialogue. A lot of the TV dialogue is truncated, most notably the Robson-Van Lutyens exchange in Episode 1, which goes on for longer on TV, and which has the Doctor deliver a wry punchline. So for as long as this book is the longest target to date, it doesn't give you all the TV dialogue, and it turns other bits of dialogue into prose. Most of Chapter 3, which has the excerpts from the Robson-Van Lutyens blow-up, and other discussions featuring solely secondary and tertiary characters, is given over to the Episode 1 cliffhanger. And this is where Pemberton excels, propelling the story forward with a mix of medium and short sentences, no run-ons like we saw last week with Ian Stewart Black's first book. Pages 39 and 40. Victoria's frenzied calls for help were soon reverberating across the entire refinery. In the control hall, the commotion caused chaos amongst the crew. Everyone was trying to establish where the screams were coming from. Van Lutyens rushed off to the impeller area, leaving Robson to stare in confused disbelief at the pipeline tube running around the walls. "Doctor! Jamie! Help me!" Victoria's calls were becoming more and more desperate, more and more hysterical. The Doctor and Jamie were rushing from one corridor to another, but although Victoria's voice seemed to be getting closer and closer, they still couldn't find out how to get to her. "Victoria!" yelled Jamie at the top of his voice. "Victoria!" The Doctor's shouts were becoming frantic. "Can you hear us, Victoria?" A penetrating, prolonged scream. The Doctor and Jamie stopped dead and turned simultaneously. Both of them were staring at the door of the oxygen storeroom. The thumping heartbeat sound was almost deafening, and as thick white foam surged uncontrollably through the ventilated grill of the oxygen room, the tendrils of the weed creature weaved and quivered towards Victoria, closer and closer, hissing and popping. Victoria screamed just one more time. Breathless stuff. Intense. Intimidating. The first time any of us saw live action clips from Fury from the Deep, well, not counting the recycled footage of the TARDIS dropping into the sea in Episode 1, used in Episode 10 of the War Games, is when the sensor footage came back from Episode 2 of the story, Chapter 4 in the book, of Mr. Oak and Mr. Quill's attack on Maggie Harris. Such intensity. Such great facial performances from Bill Burridge and John Gill. Such great direction and crazy music. You'll be happy to know that Pemberton is equally up to adapting this material in print. And he cleverly drops hints about Oak and Quill earlier in the book. One short and fat, the other tall and thin. White caps, white gloves. So that when he uses these expressions again in Chapter 4, we immediately know that Maggie Harris is in serious danger. Most Doctor Who episode cliffhangers are rigidly formulaic. The Doctor has a gun pulled on him. Companion number 1 is threatened by a monster and screams. Companion number 2 is threatened by a monster and stares stoically into the camera. The episode's Big Bad faces the camera and delivers a rant about his future plans, usually at the end of Part 3. What we don't often get are abstract, philosophical, dialogue-only cliffhangers between secondary and tertiary characters. Like the bit from Van Lutyens at the episode 2 cliffhanger, just John Abernethy and Hubert Reese, solid character actors, each with multiple Who stories in the future, including stories about aggressive greenery like the Power of Kroll or the Seeds of Doom, respectively. You can't see any menace, but you can hear it, and the characters hear it. Oh boy, do they hear it.
Chief? What's the matter? Mr. Robson? That noise from the impeller, it started again. I think we should go down and check the main thruster.
Oh, you do you?
Well, that's where we think the blockage is.
We?
Oh, Mr. Van's
got a Van Natchez. Yes, I thought he'd get his nose in. Come on.
You lot, get back to work. Mr. Van Lutyens, I want to talk to you.
Mr. Robson, there is something alive in the pipeline.
You're out of your mind. There's nothing down there.
I promise you, sir, I did hear something.
You've been unnerving my crew. Now you, get out.
Listen.
That's it? Did you hear what I said?
Rustig, now listen, will you? It's down there. In the darkness. In the pipeline. Waiting.
But if there's a drawback, it's that since we're in small studios and only have limited time for action sequences during each 25-minute episode, and the gallery must have been exhausted after overseeing the Oak and Quill sequence earlier in Episode 2, it's talk that drives the plot forward, not visuals. Which means the book in Chapter 5, building up to its chapter-ending cliffhanger, is mostly long dialogue debates between Van Lutyens and the Chief Engineer and Robson. I wouldn't say this material is slow, but it is at times a bit like those endless philosophical or scientific debates in Oppenheimer, when all you wanted to do is get to the nukes going off. This sort of wheel spinning continues into Chapter 6, which is split across two locales, Round 2, between Van Lutyens and the Chief and Robson, and then the Doctor and Victoria and Jamie in a rare mid-serial TARDIS scene. Those are usually confined to the first and last episodes only. I haven't done a formal study on this, but I can't think of too many episode 3s that have TARDIS scenes in them. The Chase episode 3, Legopolis part 3. But this isn't a bad TARDIS diversion. Very similar to a library exposition scene from any of the high school seasons on Buffy, complete with a drawing of the episode's Beast of the Week found in an ancient book of legends and superstition. Minus Xander's inappropriate wisecracks or Oz's wry observations, or Cordy interrupting to talk about herself, of course. Chapter 7 is Robson's breakdown. This is a well-worn trope of the Troughton era base under siege story template. The base commander is brash and gruff, like the similarly named Hobson in the moon base, or short and irritable, like Leader Clint in the Ice Warriors, or dangerously unstable and losing his grip, like Chief What's-His-Name in the Wheel in Space, or Selrus in the Crotons. Robson's breakdown doesn't quite work for me. In fact, it happens before he's infected by the weed creature. Story-wise, those things should have happened in reverse order. But the book gives us an added beat, explaining Robson's breakdown, page 85. Robson was married, but his wife was killed 20 years earlier in a car wreck where he was the driver. Which explains why Robson threw himself into his work and spent the next 4 years on a rig out at sea with no human contact. Also in Chapter 7, Megan Jones is seen on video screen and introduced, as Conrad said earlier, as, quote, attractive in a hard sort of way, page 94. She's mentioned in Episode 3 but not seen until later. Jamie's rescue from the weed creature in the book happens as the Doctor turns the Harris's kitchen window curtains into a rope and lassos Jamie horizontally to safety across the floor.
on TV and in the animation. This is done instead as a vertical escape through a skylight. Lastly, even though this is a monochrome story, well, unless you watch the color animation, but like Philip Hinchcliffe and the Keys of Marinus novelization, Pemberton tells his monochrome story in full color. Check this out, bottom of page 97. The sky was clear now, and in the twilight the first star of night was already visible to the naked eye. The sunset had bequeathed a dark crimson glow along the vast thin line of the horizon. The ripples on the waves were glistening like rubies, disguising the endless fronds of seaweed and foam that were drifting in on the evening tide. The afternoon thaw had dispersed most of the thin blanket of snow covering the surrounding hills, and on the beach the small pools of seawater were edged with the first signs of a hard frost. Chapter 8 is a very Victor Pemberton chapter, a mixture of deeply personal, quiet scenes between the regulars, the introduction of a forceful new character in person, Megan Jones, and two scary set pieces, Van Lutyens being dragged into the impeller, and then the Doctor and Jamie at the end of the chapter being faced with the same grim fate. Lots of highlights here. The chief engineer is never called by a proper name because, quote, mainly because few even knew his real name. Pemberton finally feels confident enough on page 102 to add humor. In his dream, Jamie was playing his bagpipes on the banks of some windswept Highland loch, but his snores were not exactly musical. Next page, his snores sounded like a Highland reel. On TV, Victoria gets the last line of the scene, lamenting about a place with no fighting, peace, and happiness. But on page 104, the Doctor gets a very 1968 conclusion. My dear child, I'd take you there tomorrow, if I knew such a place existed. Not in 1968 it didn't. Jones and Perkins first appear on page 113. Pemberton is a little harsh on them. Perkins is the second comic relief sidekick to be named Perkins in two seasons, following the Highlanders. Pemberton writes, page 114, Perkins did his best to look intelligent. It was a difficult task. That goes on for the rest of the book, too. Pemberton's Perkins receiving as many authorial kicks as Jerry Davis's Perkins in the earlier book, episode 90 of this podcast. Pemberton also tells us that Megan Jones is Welsh, but code switches to a London boardroom accent, quote, for reasons best known to herself. That is not a line written by a guy who is woke to smashing the patriarchy. Worst line of the book. Better is further down the same page as the refinery crew wait with, and this is probably a direct quote from Thoreau, quiet desperation. Chapter 9, meanwhile, has another very good signature Pemberton scene. A quiet Jamie and Zoe chat, not about the Beast of the Week, but about their thoughts and feelings. Let's give a listen.
Jamie, I didn't know you cared.
Victoria Waterfield, you tricked me, that's not fair.
I did not. I was unconscious.
What happened?
Those two engineers, they must have...
What engineers?
You know, the and the little one.
You mean the two that were with the swing?
Yes, that's right. Oh, I don't remember. I must have passed out.
I'll get my hands on them. You know, the Doctor and me, we were nearly... Hey, well, never mind about that.
Oh, Jamie, why are we always getting into trouble like this? It's the same everywhere we go.
How do you mean?
I don't know. I'm just fed up. I'm tired of one crisis on top of another. I just want some peace and quiet.
But Victoria, you're not happy with the Doctor and myself.
Oh, yes. Yes, I am, but I just...
What's the matter?
Listen.
What's the matter?
Listen, Jamie.
What is it?
Can't you hear it? It's that noise again.
Yes, but where's it coming from? Victoria, look!
Chapter 10 implies that Robson kills the security guard in his cabin. Page 144. I'm not going to read the section. It's small, but it uses the words lethal and lifeless. Nobody dies in this story on TV. Everybody possessed by the weed creature is later restored to full state. Unlike, say, The Last of Us, where there's no coming back from cordyceps. A Doctor Who serial with no fatalities is exceedingly rare. Perhaps Pemberton didn't intend for the story to have no body count. And speaking of Pemberton, You heard Conrad and I talk earlier about what unique perspective Pemberton brings to the serial that most other Troughton-era writers don't have. Chapter 10 shows the Doctor at his most helpless, spinning his wheels for all of his 17 pages, because he hasn't yet figured out how to defeat the weed creature, let alone mount a concerted counterattack. You don't often see Troughton helpless for 12 and a half minutes of story time. That's a lot of real estate in 1960s Doctor Who. But Pemberton takes us there. Chapter 11 includes one of the few bits of the book that is not on TV. The Doctor, once in the helicopter, has no idea where the weed creature's nerve center is, so has the pilot fly up and down the coast. This is not indicated on TV. It means the Doctor hasn't yet figured out that the offshore rigs, the first to fall to the weed creature, could possibly be the weed's headquarters. It's an interesting moment for Pemberton, showing a Doctor who's missed the obvious clue. For a 12-chapter book, you'd expect the 6-episode serial to take up 2 chapters apiece. Pemberton mixes it up slightly, episode 1 getting the first 3 chapters, episodes 2 through 5 getting 2 chapters apiece, and episode 6 getting a single chapter, 12, but double length at 27 pages. Pemberton is good at dropping hints very early on that it's Victoria's lungs that are going to solve the plot. Fittingly, in this her swan song story, swans not included. For plot reasons, the Doctor can't figure out till the final installment, so that's 6 weeks of waiting. Delighted to finally get there in Chapter 12, Pemberton perhaps drops the news a little too unsubtly. Quote, "It was at that crucial moment that, for the first time, the Doctor discovered the secret of the alien weed's vulnerability." I mean, the audience would have figured it out at least 6 chapters ago, but any author has to pretend that the Doctor is much more clever than we, the reader. This is not portrayed the same way on TV, by the way. The Doctor in that scene in Episode 6 does not urge her to scream Victoria scream as in the book. On TV, the Doctor isn't given the realization about the screaming until he explains it to Harris and Jones in the refinery control room a few scenes later. On page 67, we lose the TV continuity link to Enemy of the World. On TV, the Troughton Doctor learned how to fly a helicopter from Astrid. Here, he's never been in one before Episode 5, and learned instead watching the pilot on the way out to the control rig. Page 175, Victoria is, quote, "very unnerved by the thought that the survival of the human race might depend on her scream." Victoria's departure is emotional, and takes up 8 pages of text. Comparable to the departure of Susan in Episode 30 of this podcast, or comparable to the departure of Ian and Barbara, whose departure novelization is yet to come, Pemberton transcribes this faithfully, including the dinner party scene at the Harris's, a lovely touch that so few Doctor Who stories indulge, most departures being of the Shane variety. We get to see Robson restored to full strength, a fate not given to too many unraveling base commanders throughout Doctor Who. However, Robson gets 2 more TV scenes underlining the point, which the book omits. Perhaps those were penned at the last minute to fill out the runtime. Let's play those scenes. Robson's farewells.
All right, Price.
Oh, yes, thanks, sir. Back to normal.
Relief?
Crew's on their way, sir.
That you could do with a bit of shut-eye, eh?
Well, I don't know. I think I'm a bit past it.
Go out like a light, eh?
Probably.
Chief still here?
Yes, in the impeller room, sir.
Good night, Price.
Good night, sir.
Chief.
Mr. Robson?
Sound as a bell, eh?
Almost, sir.
Almost?
Still half a point off capacity.
Is it?
The main control valve was slightly damaged. They're working at it now. We'll be up to our normal output in the morning.
Still 1 or 2 minor repairs to be done.
Not tonight, Chief.
Oh, why not?
Get some sleep. Don't argue. Leave it to the relief.
Right.
Where do you lot think you're going? Another 3 minutes before your relief arrives.
Nice to know you're back to normal, sir.
If I didn't know you better, Chief, I would swear you were giving me lip.
Oh, I wouldn't dream of doing that, sir.
Wouldn't you? Night, Chief.
There is one final bit in the book that is not on TV. Jamie has something to say to Victoria, but can't quite form the words. Page 187, quote, "Jamie's courage failed. Ah, nothing. See you later." He turned and quickly made his way back toward the beach. We never do find out what Jamie McCrimmon intended to say.
but this is Victoria's final story. She leaves the line forever in the following paragraph. She may return in other Target novelizations yet to come. Her debut story, for example, one of the very last books in the original Doctor Who novelization line, but we will never get another Jamie Victoria story set after Fury from the Deep. I'm pretty sure I know what Jamie was going to say to her in the book. I can understand why they didn't go there on TV, but it would have been nice to have direct confirmation of exactly what he was thinking. Next time on Doctor Who Literature, we return to the companions of Doctor Who. We get a book that perhaps doesn't have any science fiction in it at all. It is a two-fisted spy novel featuring Harry Sullivan, written by the great Ian Martyr, in a book released the same month as Fury from the Deep. Unfortunately, the last month of Ian Martyr's too short life. Joining me once again is Jim Sangster, and we are going to go deep into the companions of Doctor Who, Harry Sullivan's War. Thank you for joining me on another episode of Doctor Who Literature. This podcast is executive produced by David Barsky and is produced by Jim Sangster and yours truly. This week's episode was written and edited by me. Our logo was designed by Jim Sangster. Special thanks to my special guest, Conrad Westmaas. This podcast can be found on most of your podcast apps of choice. You can find all past episodes at podcasters.spotify.com/pod/show/Doctor Who Lit. It really helps if you rate 5 stars and subscribe. You can find me on Blue Sky and YouTube at Doctor Who Novels, that's Dr. Who Novels, and on email at Doctor Who Literature, that's Dr. Who Literature at gmail.com. Please drop me a line with your comments, questions, and suggestions. Thank you for listening, and whatever you do, keep turning the pages.
Doctor Who Podcast Network.